Hello and welcome to the SWN Podcast. I'm your host, as always, Billy. I'm joined by another returning guest. I think you're the first returning guest this season, actually. Way back in episode 154, which was June 2022, I spoke to a fresh-faced Daisy Jenkins, a couple matches into the biz, and she's back on the show with quite a few more matches
Hello.
under your belt.
Just a couple.
It's just a couple, which we're going to dive into. I already asked you off recording, but this is now on the record. How you doing?
Very well, thank you. How are you?
Good, good. On the record, I am fantastic. Absolutely cannot complain at all in the slightest. Off the record, maybe different, but yeah. So it's all good. It's good. Like we were saying just off, this is the height of a heat wave. Well, no, actually, this is the heat wave now, just dissipating a little bit. The weekend was horrific, as
Yeah,
we're
I
recording
quite need
this.
some help.
And now we're just it's well up here anyway. It's a little bit cooler, still got a little bit of a heat to it, so you can still get your washing out because I'm old. That's now what I think about. More likely, when you look out in the morning, you see the weather, you go, "Hey, get my sheet suit today."
Days for the washing out.
That's
Yeah.
get the sheets out, and then
Simple things. The simple things.
you've got to find the little things to be excited about when you're well, we're the same age pretty much, and I'm the one that's getting excited by putting my washing out, and you're gallivanting around the world beating people up. So that's the sliding doors of life. So yeah, like I said, it has been a few matches since our last chat way back when. You just started. I think you had your match at ICW, maybe had a couple one or two matches elsewhere, and then since then it's been coming up Daisy, so to speak. So what are your thoughts on your wrestling career so far in that last year since we last spoke?
Mental, absolutely mental. I've said it a few times on a couple of other podcasts, and I think like I've posted about it a couple of times as well. But I think especially when I first started, because I was a little bit older when I started, I never expected it to be anything more than, potentially getting a match or, working towards something. And everything that I've done in the past year and the past sort of however long it's been since we last spoke has just been an absolute dream come true. Like, I couldn't, if I was to write it down at the beginning, if someone came to me and said, "How would you want this to go?" and I wrote it down, I couldn't have written it down better than the way that it's going. So, I'm loving every single minute, and I just want to keep going and see what the future holds, because I every time something new comes up, I'm blown away by it. So, got lots to talk about for sure.
Absolutely. I was speaking to Andy when we had Andy Roberts on to talk about one of the FPWA shows. We were talking about the people that are on it, and yourself, you came up, and we did speak about that. That seems to be the thing that pops up. It's like you're kind of our version at the moment of like the DDP trope, kind of thing, the Batista trope, as in it started a bit later, but they've went full all in. I suppose that's probably the better way to put it. I went all in on it, and he was pretty much saying things like, because of that, you're just making sure you make every opportunity the best opportunity, which is what you've done in the last year and a half, certainly. Anyway, which is that conscious? You just went, right, I need to, if I'm only going to do this once, I'm going to make sure it's the best thing I can do.
Yeah, absolutely. I don't waste a minute. I think with being older and starting it, I just wanted to soak up as much as I possibly could. And I tried to train as much as possible, and I still do. So every chance that I get, I'm in the ring. I'm learning from new people, different people, as many people as I possibly can. Just trying to soak it all in and try to apply it. It's also taking feedback and trying to apply that as quickly as possible as well, just to sort of keep the momentum going. And it can be quite draining at times, but I think like it goes back to what you said, if you've got one chance at something, you've got to make it count. So that does go through my mind every single day. And I probably think about it way too much. And I probably let other things sort of I probably don't spend as much time on other things than I maybe should, but it's starting to get to the point now where, you know, I'm a lot more confident, so I don't need to spend so much time worrying or anything like that, which has been a bit of a bad habit of mine over the past year and a half. But we're finally getting to the point where I feel like I maybe have a bit more balance. But it's exactly what you said. It's go all in, or, you know, it's that go big or go home type feeling that I have. And I'm just trying to do the best that I possibly can.
So I'm just having a look. The last time we spoke, it would have been about a week or so, maybe after your match at Community Pro against Ellie Armstrong and Harmony Sky. So that's how far back we are with everything. And then straight after that, the month after, you ended up at Fair City Wrestling in a title match. So that's mad. So when it came to putting yourself out there, like you're saying, it's you're taking advantage. You have to make every opportunity count. Were you quick to try and put a CV out? Was it more word of mouth? How did you end up coming by these opportunities? Was it just turning up to shows going, have you got a spot? Just how did it work?
It was a bit of everything, to be honest. It was more word of mouth than anything. And I just tried to put as much out on social media as I possibly could. And I think obviously working with Andy, people would ask for recommendations and he would put me forward for things. And then, you know, there was a little bit of pressure with all of that, with still being so new. It's kind of like, okay, well, am I ready yet? And, you know, going into every single opportunity that I got, wanting to prove myself and, you know, prove that it would be worth having me back, which has worked out in the majority of cases. But I think, certainly to begin with, it was very quick. Things just kept coming one after the other, and it was hard to keep up with, but you know, I'm glad that I managed to perform the way that I did, so that people did want to see me again and wanted me to come back. And then it's just kind of went from there, to be honest. You get asked back places, the more opportunities you get, the more kind of more experienced people you get put in with. It'll just build from there, and I've been extremely lucky for the way that it's worked out that way. So yeah, it was a bit crazy, and it still is.
It's just one of those, especially when you're looking for references. I mean, there's few that better you could have in your reference check sheet of Andy Roberts, who else at CPW, Jason Reed, maybe Johnny Lyons, or, they're guys that have been around the block quite a bit, so they've seen the good and the very bad. So if there's anyone in your kind of reference CV point where you can go, yeah, this guy, see what I can do in training and see what I can do, that's a pretty good trio or two or three folk that you can have in your back pocket to call upon.
Yeah, absolutely. I'm extremely lucky.
And I mean, it's not only that. I mean, obviously, I'm from this side. I'm on the other side of the barrier, and clearly, I can see what your work putting in. Not only because of your looks, quite unique when it comes to the wrestling, because you've got the throw, like most of the time you've got the throwback 80s gear. I'm going to speak about tassels soon, because I'm very intrigued about that. But you've also got, you also do the social media aspect to it, which I think sometimes is lost for maybe not so much newer folk, but just in general, where you need to tell people to come to the building to see you. So when it comes to things like match footage, is that one of the first things after you get advice, of course, and how you could do better? Because I know, as you've said, you're an overthinker, so you'll probably think about every little thing you've done wrong in a match before you think of the good stuff. Is getting match footage one of the most important things for you, so you can make these reels and make sure you can advertise yourself and shows at the same time?
Yeah, and I think to begin with, it was important just to watch things back and kind of see how I looked and how I could improve. So if someone would give me feedback, I could go back and look at that and go, right, okay, I see what they meant there. Obviously, I could clip little bits here and there with things that I thought went well, but on the whole, at the beginning, I was very reluctant to share footage because I was sort of like my biggest critic. So it was mostly just photos and things. But when you do have good footage, it makes a huge difference, because you can kind of show, certainly you can show progression, and that's, you know, sometimes what it's all about, of, you know, like This is where I started and this is where I am now. And, you know, this is the stuff that I've been learning and this is what I learned from you and I took it with me and I went and done it here and this is a video of me doing it, you know. But it's good, especially now going into matches with people. Maybe for the second or third time, you can start to build like a little bit of a buzz around what it is that you're going to be doing because you've had matches before. So it's certainly something that I enjoy doing. I do all of the social media stuff myself and I've kind of taught myself how to make all these cool reels and things like that. And it's something that I'm enjoying. It's a part of it that I do like doing. It's hard to get match footage sometimes, but I've been a little bit more confident with asking people to take pictures and send me clips and things like that. So I do recommend that people do that. And I think people enjoy watching what I've been putting out. So it's good. It's, you know, I get a lot of good feedback from it and a lot of love for the things that I put out there. So it's good.
It baffles me. I mean, unless you've got a weekly or whatever, like, we've got Pro 2 does their show and FCW does their show. I don't understand why we can't get to see matches if you're not putting them out in a platform to be paid for. Which, like, I'm up in the Northeast, so I only get to see wrestling live because, you know, cost of living and whatever. Maybe once a month, twice a month if I'm very lucky. I don't get to see half of these shows, but I would love to. But yeah, just that's a pet peeve for wrestling, just for me in general. But I'll leave that to the side because this is not me ranting. It's an interview with yourself instead. So we were talking about the footage then. One of your big opportunities came a couple of months later, which was Dane Spotting, which is Copenhagen Championship Wrestling, and they were taping that show. I think they were for their. Well, no, they were. Were they? Who knows?
Yeah, they tape it for Danish television.
Danish television, that was it. I wasn't sure if it was that or their grunge show. You had a little bit of experience with working a hard cam for ICW, so did you feel like you kind of knew how to come into that, or was it just a little bit different and how it was set up?
Yeah, I mean, that sort of thing has been quite interesting for me, especially with working with people sort of across the country who have never worked a taping before. And a lot of our training is sort of based around that positioning for cameras. Because of the way that our school's set up, the ring only faces out one way. So we sort of see that as, you know, the front of the ring is the crowd side and also hard cam side. So it's just drilled into me at this point of, you know, what way to do things and what position to be in. So certainly for ICW at the beginning, you know, it was in my head of what way I wanted to run certain things or where I needed to be for a certain aspect. And then the more that I'd done that, the more it just kind of sticks in your head. So going to other places where there is a camera, it feels natural to me now. And then obviously if you've got a crowd and a camera, you kind of pick and choose which way you're going to do it, with prioritizing the crowd, obviously, because they're the ones who are in the building. But yeah, it's just one of those things. Not that I don't think about it, but when I'm before matches, I certainly think about it. And then I just find myself looking for cameras now, especially, and even photos, getting good photos in the match, you know, like looking for the photographer. It's a really interesting aspect to it that you wouldn't have really thought about before getting into it, of being in the right position and, you know, what your face is doing and all that sort of stuff, because you can get some terrible photos too. Yeah, it's a really interesting aspect, actually. It's a good question.
Thank you. There's someone who now, like, does the montages for the Road Trip episodes. I can attest that, yeah, there's some awful pictures that I've taken, and it's no fault of the person in the ring. It's just a split second moment that can go from just a nice face to just something that you don't know what it is. But the point about you asking for pictures and asking for photos, right? That's the same thing. Videos. Is it also drives your fan engagement up as well, which is a nice little bonus at the same time, because you're asking fans to get involved with you and they, like, support me by doing, and it's free. You know, it's not like they have to buy merch, although you've got merch, which we will plug. But
I
you don't have
do,
to buy
yeah.
merch. Just take a picture, and that helps you. It helps them. It gets them involved. It's just when you look at wrestling in a business sense and that kind of thing, it is very interesting. And same with like working a hard cam side and all that kind of stuff. It's things you don't think about until you actually do it, kind of thing, isn't it? So moving on from that, I've got Discovery. As well, we're gonna rattle through your last 18 months, and then we've got loads
Yeah.
of questions, it seems. But we've got Discovery, which is a probably one of the best promotions, or one of the biggest promotions in Scotland right now. So it's a big opportunity against Lana Austin, who I don't think he would have faced at this point. I mean, that what 7 months in at that point. So you talked about like not enjoying your performance, be critical of your own performances. But when you come to getting a match like Discovery with a very, are they a vocal crowd, or they more like a kind of in betweeny marquee? No, Mark's not the word I want to look for, but more in tune with independent wrestling crowd. And you're against Lana Austin, who's got a big reputation. How do you approach a match like that? Do you just watch lots of footage so you know what she can do, what you can do around it? What's your kind of process for a bigger opponent?
Yeah, I mean, that's been my sort of approach to everything over the past sort of 18 months because I've been in with so many new and experienced people. I've always made sure that before I go into a match, I watch what they do. So that I'm prepared in that way. And it was no different with that one. I'd met Lana before. So it was, but you know, it was no less nerve-wracking. And it was probably the biggest opportunity at that point that I'd had, especially with being on the anniversary show and things like that. It was, you know, it was a big crowd. But I just had to trust it. Just had to trust the process and kind of, you know, trust that I'd trained hard enough to be in the position that I was in. And I think I got asked about that same match on another podcast, and I think I said, you know, when I got opportunities like that, I the first thing I would always think was, well, why me? And then it kind of got to the point where I would be like, well, why not me? So it's just preparing yourself as much as possible, and putting on the best performance that I possibly could. And I loved that match. It was brilliant, and I think it was a real showcase of how far I'd come in such a short space of time, and that if you put me in with experienced people, then I'll step up. So I do hold that one very close to my heart, I think, because it was a definite confidence booster for me. And Discovery is probably one of my favorite places to work. It's just everything about it. It's just amazing.
But you mentioned that the why not, well, the why me to why not me. But you're one of those wrestlers that like I said, you're quite unique when it comes to your presentation and your style, which is not something which is great now in Scottish wrestling, because I don't think there's any one wrestler, especially the women's side of things, that are the same. Everyone's got a thing now, a character. They're not just this is the women's match kind of thing. There's stuff to at least gravitate towards. I'm going to speak about tassels, because I'm just, you see, there's a little bit, there was a time where, of course, you were the Sherry Martel look, which you still bring back. And then I was noticing that every so often you were trying this different kind of gear, a little bit of the face paint and the big tassel jacket. I was in my head, I was going like a Mickie James kind of jacket, you know, the hardcore country kind of stuff. And then you'd come back to the Sherry Martel thing. Was this just you trying to maybe just try and branch out a little bit just to create Daisy Jenkins instead of an 80s throwback? What was your process there?
Yeah, so I mean, if you look closely at all of the gear, I still try to keep it sort of 80s/90s inspired. It's just the original gear in my mind is like perfect for family friendly shows. You know, kids think I look like a superhero, and the parents understand what it is that I'm trying to throw back to. But I do think that it can make me look potentially, what's the best word for it? Intimidating is not the word, but doesn't look like I'm, you know, it maybe looks like I can be overlooked looking like that. You know, I'm there just to have fun, blah, 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 blah. Whereas the other gear is just, it's an expression of my sort of progression in myself, the not just in wrestling, but personally in terms of confidence and things like that. And just feeling like a wrestler. Not that I didn't in the other gear, because I, you know, I wore it on Thursday, and we know what the result of that was. But it's just having a different look and just, you know, bringing something different. I do plan on having the makeup regardless of what gear I'm wearing. It's just unfortunate that sometimes women's locker rooms don't have mirrors in them for some reason. So it's very hard to do on a small mirror. But it's kind of what you're saying. It's trying to feel out who Daisy Jenkins is and have different looks for different shows. And I think I do see some shows as almost like special occasions. So having a different look for that just makes me feel more confident about it.
You mentioned confidence. That was kind of my thought, because it's a bit more, because firstly, your 80s throwback gears, everything's covered pretty much, except your arms. But this one's, it's a little bit more on show kind of thing, and you're, it's a bit more of a traditional kind of wrestling, nowadays more wrestling gear kind of thing. So it's, you say it's more about confidence. So is that just more a case of confident being able to express yourself a bit more as well? That people aren't gonna, I don't know, negatively say anything towards your gear now that you've, because you feel confident in it kind of thing. And I'm rambling here, but is that kind of the same thing? You're also confident in your own skin as well as your abilities.
I think so a little bit. I'm also not really one for focusing on if anybody wants to say anything negative towards me. I kind of feel like if anyone has anything negative to say, then it's a projection of their own insecurities. So I'm not one to kind of feel a certain way about that. And I would never choose gear for the worry that somebody would say something, because then you'd never decide on anything. So it's more just about my own personal confidence and like confidence in the ring, and just how I want to portray myself in that given situation, in that given match, with that given role or whatever it is. But the tassels are the most fun part of it. So that's why I chose.
How often do you just spend the time just swishing before you go anywhere, go out to the ring?
I actually try not to, because I get caught in stuff. So, and it all gets caught together, because there's a lot of zips and sequins and things like that. So, I try not to. I just kind of keep my arms down by my side until I jump out. It's also very hard to take that jacket off. So I have to be very careful that I don't embarrass myself, like trying to take it off like halfway through. But yeah.
You talked about like not taking on negativity and that kind of respect. I think that's probably another advantage of you being a bit older and being an adult when you're coming to wrestling. You're not an 18-year-old who's thinking of every negative thing that people could possibly say in the world. You're coming in as a grown ass woman. You're just like, oh, I'm here to do my job. I don't care, as long as I feel confident, as long as my superiors, my peers, that's fair, my peers are confident in me, then that's really all that matters, you know, kind of thing. It's a really nice, it's a nice outlook to have, especially when I'm speaking to guys or girls that are maybe a year in, but they're still like 17 and they're terrified that people will call them bald because they've got maybe the tiniest faint look of a bald spot. And that's them, their whole year ruined in that moment. It's just a nice outlook.
It's not to say that comments haven't affected me, but I feel like I've got tools to kind of bring myself around to what I feel like my truth is. And I've got an incredible support network, both outside of wrestling and inside of wrestling. So there's always someone that I can talk to. You know, so I used to feel quite lonely with it at the beginning, but that was just for purely not really knowing anyone. Whereas now, it's you know, it's really something in terms of the amount of support that I have. So I don't feel like I need to let any negativity affect what I'm doing, because it, you know, it's not going to help anyone And maybe they were just having a bad day. So it doesn't, yeah, not that it doesn't bother me, but I try not to let it affect me.
Let's move on to some positivity then. We've welled a little bit there, so we can pick it up with a little bit of fun. So firstly, Fife Pro Wrestling Asylum. Andy will hate that. They've been kind of doing a versus series at the moment. They've been inviting schools, going to schools, and just kind of battling it out. So the Iron Girders, mm-hmm. which had a match up recently, and back in June, I think it was. But the one I want to speak about is New Wave. So a New Wave Wrestling Academy, they came up. So from Wales, they came up here. You had a match with Dani Luna, which former NXT UK star, currently in Impact Wrestling. And that's probably, I mean, you've wrestled Emerson Jane by that point. You've wrestled Lana, as you mentioned, and those that have been in, like Molly Spartan, who've done big things. But I'd say Dani Luna is probably one of your biggest opponents you would have had, certainly at that point. So when you, again, a lot of things I say is process. That seems to be the buzzword for me today. But when you process going into a match with someone who has done NXT UK stuff, who's in Impact and has got quite a big hype as well because she was able to make it to those companies, again, how do you approach it? Is it just one of those things where, again, you just look through the footage, see what you can work with, what you can do with it, or is one of those kind of matches just a bit more nerve-wracking for you because of the reputation Dani would have?
Yeah, all of that. So same process. Again, I'd met Dani Luna before, and I watched everything of hers that I could. I was terrified for that match. I understood how big of an opportunity it was for me, and the reasons why Andy had booked that match. And there was, the wanting to prove myself, and again, that sort of thing that I spoke about earlier of, put me in with experienced people and I'll step up kind of thing. Not to say that I was disappointed with how that match went, but I was way too nervous for it. I enjoyed myself. It was a great match. I loved working with her. I could wrestle her every single day. But I needed that match and I needed that opportunity to actually level up afterwards. It was after that everything started kind of falling into place and I felt like things clicked. Whether it was, the way that we worked together, the way that it was, put together and the way that it ended up being, whatever it was, the combination of all of that sort of led to the way that I approach things now. So again, it's one of my favorite matches for that. And I appreciate her for everything that she supported me with since as well. So it was one of my favorites and it was a great night. Like those truth shows are just something special. And that one was for sure.
I was having a look from that point onwards, yeah, because you had that was Dani Luna, that was March 2023. So that point on, you did Copenhagen Championship Wrestling again. You were back at ICW, stuff for girders, and then you were down to Wales. So that's a fair distance to go to wrestle. I know, I think you said in your last one that you do a bit of traveling for the fake work that you do outside of wrestling. but going down to Wales to do wrestling, was that your first proper big road trip kind of thing with everyone? And did you learn a few things maybe you didn't want to learn in that kind of, in those hours?
it was a long car journey there, and the one back was even longer because the car broke a little, so it ended up being like 12 hours back. So yes, I learned a lot, stuff that I will not say outside of that car. But it was a lot of fun. It was the first time that I'd wrestled outside of Scotland, so again, it was such a huge opportunity. And New Wave are incredibly special. Just the combination of people and the shows that they put on, they're absolutely phenomenal. So to have been a small part of it was very overwhelming and a lot of fun. It was the first time that I'd properly played heel as well, if we're gonna go into the sort of back.
I am very interested to see what Daisy Jenkins is as a heel, because every time I've seen little footage and photos, you're just smiley and happy, and I can't imagine it any other way.
Well, do you know, the past 5 weeks basically has been all of that. So there will be footage at some point. Excuse me, but yeah, it was a lot of fun. I really enjoy Wales just in general. I've been over to train a couple of more times, not as much as I wanted to. But yeah, New Wave are exceptionally special, and I would implore anyone to keep an eye out on anyone who's coming out of there.
And you mentioned that was the first time wrestling outside of Scotland. I did listen to your chat with Touchgrass Wrestling, because that brings me to my next talking point here, which is WrestleFest, DXB, up at, just casually in Dubai, Scotland, Wales, Dubai. So I've heard a bit about WrestleFest, because I think it was mentioned in that podcast, but Jason Reed, I saw he's done a little bit there, and he's done a little bit there as well. And I was hearing when you were speaking to the guys at Touchgrass, I was the first thing I wrote down afterwards was superstar experience was my note, because it sounded like you were just treated like a queen when you were there, kind of thing. Because you're getting picked up, getting to do all this cool stuff. And was that a moment where you could sit back and go, yeah, I think I've not that you've made it, but it's like, yeah, this is probably one of the best wrestling experiences I've had. And I haven't even had the match yet, kind of thing, was it?
It was surreal. It was really surreal, because it was the two aspects of my life all in the same one. I was out there for work, and I managed to do the wrestling as well. And it was just the first time that I'd ever really went somewhere by myself, like completely by myself. And the only people that I knew out there was obviously, I'd met Shaheen a couple of months earlier than that, because he came and worked with us at FPWA, on that FPWA New Wave show. So I went and trained at their training school for a couple of nights, and then we had the show on the Saturday, and it was just honestly bonkers. Like, it was, I was standing there and just, like, I couldn't believe that it was for me. You know, I was like, how have I ended up here? And how am I, like, just as my music hit, I'm standing behind the curtain going, this is crazy. Like, you're just about to jump out there and you're in Dubai. It was just, it's my favorite experience, not just in wrestling, but I think just one of my favorite experiences in my whole life. The amount that you can pack into 4 or 5 days if you want to, is incredible.
It's just when you were recounting it, and I recommend anyone to go to that Touchgrass guys. They seem to be really, it's a really good setup they have for their chats.
Yeah.
But it just sounded incredible that you kind of got there, did a bit of, was a hand gliding, a bit of all that kind of stuff and all that. And then, you're wrestling. Not even just a match, though. You're against one of the first graduates. Is it one of their first women's matches, probably in there as well? It's not just heading over there and having a match. You're a part of history at the same time. Not to put any additional pressure onto that particular match for you, but it's quite big.
it was crazy. It was second ever women's match in Dubai. First ever women's match between international talent and local talent. And it felt special, everybody understood it. Everybody got it. Everybody in that room understood how special it was. And she'd never really had a proper match before. She'd done a couple of bits on some previous shows, so maybe like shorter matches. And Shaheen kind of gave us creative freedom almost. He kind of gave it to me, and because I went and trained and stuff, he was kind of see what you think, see what you can do, and just go out and have fun. It was essentially the remit for it. But the crowd out there are incredible, absolutely incredible. They absolutely love it, and if you do something that they've never seen before, they go crazy. and it's just electric. Like when you watch back the videos, it's loud, but when you're there in person, it is so loud. And that was the thing that Andy and Jason Reed told me before I went out, was just enjoy the crowd because you'll never feel anything else like it. And that's exactly what I've done.
So when you come think of it though, what was that? That was May. So you're about a year you've been doing this at that point. And
just think, a year.
Yeah, I mean, in ring, of course, you would have been training beforehand, but that, so a year you went from a match where you got flattened a bit by Teonga at the Asylum, and then a year later ish you're in front of a rabid Dubai crowd for a historic match, which you were there on your own. There wasn't anyone else with you, kind of thing. You got there yourself, and it's just that seems to be a nice kind of closing of your rookie year chapter, and couldn't have been an any better kind of closing into the next.
I'm actually kind of emotional listening to you say it like that. Yeah,
that's why I do like make my guests cry.
I'll try not to cry, but yeah, absolutely mental.
But so from that point onwards, then you were back in Kirkintilloch the month after. So you know it was a little bit of the come down, I suppose. It wasn't as exciting as
yeah, the Kirkintilloch is just as mad, I tell you that.
I don't doubt that for a second, because if it's anything like any crowd that seems to be looking sharps involved with, there's always some sort of just madness involved. But that in itself was also a historic match at Copenhagen Championship Wrestling, which was the Alice Inc, yourself, Lexi Lux, Ruby Roberts. So I think it was their first like femme fatal four way for
that was just the start of last month.
So it is August. There we go. Right. I've cage matches missed a month, but we're fine. We're all good. But yeah, so it's still going from the historic Dubai to Kirkintilloch, which the crowd's more terrifying than maybe electric. But that in itself, when I saw that match announced, I was super excited, because I've seen Lexi Lux before. I've interviewed her on this podcast, and she seems like the most terrifying person I may ever never meet in real life. Ruby, know what Ruby's all about. Alice Inc, a name I heard quite a lot. We've got to chat with her on the podcast as well, realizing that all four of these I've had a chat with, which is nice.
Well, that's cool.
Yeah, there you go. It's cool when I see wrestling cards come up and I go, yep, got them, but I'm going to have to get them now. Okay. Complete it. But that's still a big match. And Lexi is a bit more of a hardcore wrestler. Alice is got more of a kickboxing background. Or I can't remember what her martial art discipline is. It was a couple months ago since I spoke to her. Ruby's a brawler. And yourself, you've got the kind of lucha, a little bit of technical hybrid kind of style. So it's a nice mix of everything. Was that kind of match where, I don't want to say dream match, but it's a match that you can maybe play about with some different styles in with obviously trying to win the match itself?
Yeah, it was an interesting dynamic as well. Just like you say, in terms of styles, so trying to prepare for that is very difficult, because you have to be almost prepared for everything. But yeah, it was a lot of fun, and especially getting to wrestle Alice, because I'd seen a lot of her stuff beforehand, and you know, I always enjoy working with Ruby. And meeting Lexi as well. So, it was a really good night. I really enjoyed that. And again, like the confidence taken away from doing these different types of matches, because you can get used to doing singles matches and then, you know, you get put in a four-way and it's, you know, completely different. Completely different. And you kind of have to think on your feet quite a lot of time, and they're usually longer too, and you're, you know, timing and all that sort of stuff is a bit mad. So yeah, it was a great experience. I really enjoyed that one.
And before we move on to the questions, which there seems to be lots of, we're going to go from this past week, or this past Thursday. For those that are unaware, we were actually due to have our chat last Monday, but we had to move it to this Monday where we're speaking. And I'm very glad that we did, because at Truth or Dare, FPWA's Truth or Dare, you became officially the hardest wrestler, or I think you're still the hardest man. That's how it's classed as. You're the hardest man in Fife.
I am.
So you defeated Tommy Cartel, the previous hardest man in Fife, Duke Cannon, Hunter Sampson, and Talon Jr. And
Yes.
you're it's official. You're the hardest
It's
man in Fife.
official. I am the hardest man in Fife.
So I know
Probably
these.
hardest wrestler, but yeah.
I know both. So I hear about these FPWA shows, and you know, like you said, you've already mentioned Truth being a great atmosphere. Tommy, of course, has been running riot at those Truth shows for quite a while, talking a big game and backing it up during that time, and which is riling people up. Was there just a massive, like, I don't know, outworth of breath that people finally saw Tommy Cartel dethroned, and you were now the hardest wrestler in Fife? Was what was that moment when the three count was made?
Oh, everyone loved it. Everyone went mad, apart from Tommy. If you look at one of my latest photos where I'm standing in the ring, you can see all the other guys on the ground, and you can see Tommy with his hands, the head in his hands, realizing that he'd missed out. But it was yeah, the reaction to that was unbelievable. It was a lot of fun.
When you see something like that, though, of course, nowadays we're getting to the case of where everyone's a wrestler. It's not women's wrestling, big men wrestling, etc. But if you went back maybe 5 years ago, you probably wouldn't have ever got an opportunity like that because you're a woman. And so to now go into that, and you are the hardest wrestler in Fife, and you've got the win and the tick in the win column to prove it. It's not only having those big moments like in Dubai, but also that's a big moment for just wrestling, women's wrestling in general, that when you look at it, you came in, you're the only female there, and you came out the winner at the same time. And that's just another cool accolade to throw into Daisy Jenkins, just less than 2 years in this world.
It's huge. It's huge. And, like, you know, it's especially, you know, there's a video of my entrance into that match, because you've got five people. It can end at any time. But somebody new comes out every sort of like 2 minutes or so. And somebody filmed my entrance into that match, and you can hear little kids talking about the fact, like, oh wow, how is she going to do this? Because all of the other ones in there are boys. And I'm like, yeah, like, just watch me, you know? So I think it's cool to have a dynamic like that, especially for kids watching, because they get to see cool stuff. But also it kind of just shows that it's wrestling, you know? The girls can be as good as the guys. And, you know, depending on who you're in with, it's the luck of the draw. So I came out on top that night.
And then those kids, one of the, at least one of them, maybe it's one of the kids is a girl, and they're going to go, well, she can do that. I can be a wrestler and beat all the big boys up as well.
That's
so,
it.
So inspiring folk as well as being the hardest wrestler in Fife. So I'm going to scroll past all the pictures of my child to try and find the questions. Because it wouldn't be a podcast without you mentioning them at least once. It's like mentioning WrestleZone in one of these podcasts. It happens at least once every time. Right. So we'll jump into the ones that were sent to yourself. And then, because I've got like a few that got sent to me. One we've kind of answered in our previous chat was Callum Mack asking, how old were you when you got into wrestling and who inspired you? So I'll refer him back to that first chat, but I'll tweak the question as in, who's inspiring you now? So who are you watching now that you're a year in, you're seeing who you can kind of pick pieces from to make Daisy Jenkins even more evolved?
Oh, that's so interesting. I think my inspiration is coming from those that are around me. So the more I get to wrestle Emerson Jane, Molly Spartan, Casey, and, you know, the more that I branch out into like different promotions, and I've now done two shows down south as well, so getting sort of more into the UK scene rather than just solely Scotland, is kind of opening up new opportunities and kind of showing me the level that I want to get to, and kind of having the support of the women that are at the top of the scene in the UK really does inspire me to try and get to the same level or as do as best as I can to be involved in it in my own way.
So I've got Redfield, first from FPWA, just asking for what your goals on the back half, well, for the back half of 2023.
Okay. So I've pretty much met all of my goals for this year. The only one that I've got left is to hit a move from the top rope. So we'll see if that comes true. But other than that, I've got some really cool matches coming up. Not many of them are announced yet, but I just want to have fun with all of them. I just want to end the year on a high and be able to look back on the 31st of December and go, what the hell was that? How did that happen? I just want to continue and try and get in as much as possible before the year ends, because I'm looking at the date and I'm realizing that we're so close to the end of the year and so much has happened already, and I just want to do as much as I possibly can.
That's absolutely fair enough. So for folks that are listening and watching, go to Daisy Jenkins match and you may see her hit a top rope move, and then that'll make her year. So that's, if there's any incentive to go to show now, that has to be it.
Yeah.
And we've got wee Colin T asking, who's your dream opponent to wrestle?
Oh, it will always be Becky Lynch.
Nice and simple. Oh. Is that number one? Have you got?
Yeah.
Fair?
Number one.
Fair enough.
She's the one that, I think I spoke about it in our last one. Mm-hmm. But from watching her at the beginning was the reason why I started. So I owe a lot to her.
Perfect. So we've got the Westy. I was about to say her Instagram handle, which would have been weird. Westy has asked, how does it feel to be the new hardest person in Fife? We've kind of covered that, but we've just got a couple words just to bask in the glow of being the hardest wrestler in Fife.
It feels right. Feels like the right time.
Perfect. We've got Ashley Vega asking, Daisy versus Ashley Extreme Rules match. I emoji.
Yeah, why not?
There you go. Book it. I don't have any power. So, yeah, somebody book that. We've got Judas Grey with loads, but not the question that people may think. I'll get to that one in a second, though. We'll go Ian Skinner.
Oh.
I don't know if he's made a spell mistake, but you may be able to explain if it's an inside reference. I don't get.
Oh, dear. I'm scared.
He just put rat bump.
Yeah.
Okay, is that
it's an inside joke.
Okay.
Nobody would understand.
I thought he just like it was a new way to say favorite. I thought it was just a cool new thing that people were going rate bump. Yeah. Because
nah.
Ian's odd that way. Thank you for the question, Ian. So Judas Grey sent in three questions, and they're all fairly nice. There's no DMG involved this time. It's actually been quite good with asking questions that are relevant this time, last few months. So Judas Grey asks, favourite opponent? So you mentioned Roxy, you mentioned Lana Austin. Any other favourites that you've had?
Emerson Jane, Molly Spartan, Casey, everyone, Ashley Vega, Angel Hayes. There's so many. I can't choose. I genuinely can't choose because I've enjoyed working with everybody. Because everybody's so different. Like you said at the start, like, because everybody's so different, no match is the same. I think, like, my favorite match, so that maybe not like we'll go for like favorite opponent, but my favorite match was me versus Emerson Jane at Disco in Livingston.
Excellent choice. I'm a big fan of Emerson, but people will not be surprised by that. Judas asking, who are your ones to watch?
I was just thinking,
when you were mentioning all those names, so I think you've completed Scottish wrestling and women's side of things. So, you know,
yeah.
you've sort of started battling the men and becoming the hardest wrestler in Fife. So maybe that's just the way it's progressing now.
It's so hard because everybody that I feel like is one to watch is are people who are starting to burst out onto the scene, you know. So like, you know, not being biased with FPWA people, but you know, people like Frank Gallo, Tommy Cartel, Talon Jr., The Par, The Meat Factory, they're all doing amazing things. And I think, you know, they've done what they can this year, and next year will be even bigger for them. So I think, you know, looking out for anyone coming out of FPWA would be a safe bet.
Fantastic. And the last one he asked is build your own truth card.
Oh wow. That's gonna take me too long. It's gonna take me too long. It depends on what the because if it was just FPWA people or if we were doing a versus.
There you go. That's it. Could be versus any company. It could be any company in the UK. It could be WrestleFest could come over and they can come to this side this time. That's the beauty with wrestling at the moment as well, especially kind of versus series is literally you can get matches anywhere, anyone, anytime. Which
to be honest, I would like to see an FPWA versus New Wave part two, but with different people on the card, because there's so many down there that are amazing, and there's so many people that we have that have progressed since the last one, and I think we could have even more good matches between the two schools, so I'll go with that one.
That's a nice diplomatic answer as well, because then you don't need to actually pick people. With that as well, we talked about our series with New Wave. Is there any other promotions that you think, yeah, I could probably represent FPWA and fight them, like Fair City or I'm now Rev Pro, maybe not FPWA versus Rev Pro, you know, the world is your oyster.
I feel like that's, you know, a big ask, although Rev Pro would be class. Yeah, I think, like, you know, people are doing good things at Fair City. I think the last show, you know, there was pretty much someone from FPWA on each match. So I think somebody did make a comment online saying that it was pretty much like an FPWA versus FCW, which is quite cool. So I think that will, you know, there's a good relationship there, so that will continue, and there's some really good matches booked going forward there. So I'm sure everybody will have loads of fun with that. Other than that, I find it quite hard. I got asked this question on another podcast, and I don't really know what other schools are really, you know, like down south. I don't know many of them, so like I'm not sure who else we could do that kind of show with. I think we'll continue to work with Girders as well. They've got so many good people coming through too. So I think next year is just going to go crazy for that sort of thing. So I'm really looking forward to it.
You might finally tick off England on the list of countries.
I've done England twice now.
Oh, sorry. Honestly, the Germans' cage match are ruined. What's England? So you made it to England.
I made it to England. When was it? 2 weeks ago and last week. 2 weeks in a row, actually.
Wow. So finally you've entered the old enemy and to show them. And this is before you were crowned the hardest wrestler as well. So you're just giving them a wee preview of it. So how was the English crowd? Did you find, or were you stuck with any, you know, it had to be Scottish, so they would boo you? What was the kind of, I'm just more intrigued now because I don't have any notes on this. So,
yeah, it was different, but it was really cool. The first one was so last minute. It was for True Grit in Leeds. The venue was incredible. I've got pictures on my Instagram. It was like an old church, but it was the sound. See, whenever you done a move and the bump, it was just incredible. And the crowd were amazing. But I'd literally got a phone call at 10:30 in the morning. And by 11:30, I was in the car down to Leeds to wrestle. So that was loads of fun. And then the second one last week was at UKW. So myself, Molly Spartan, Tommy Cartel and Frank Gallo went down there, and they've got a 20-foot ring, which is the same size as the WWE ring. So it was good to get experience in that. And they have like a whole arena set up. They've got a YouTube series and everything. So yeah, it was really good. Great experience.
Nothing to keep an eye out for then. So not only will Daisy be on a screen near you in a 20-foot ring, but also might hit a top rope move. So this is all the teasers that we need for the rest of the year.
There's so many things.
Perfect. Well, thank you very much for taking the time to catch up. I'm glad that we did it, because you're one of my favorite guests to have on, just because you just exude positivity, and that's the most important thing. Especially when you get guests that are a bit, I haven't had any properly glum guests, but you're very open with having a chat. So that's probably the most important thing for. And when it comes
I appreciate you and all your support as well. So
when it comes to podcasts, I think we must be one of your first, I'm guessing. So how are you finding the podcast media game now with everyone trying to get a piece of Daisy Jenkins for a chat?
I've done a couple now. You were the first one. And I've done a couple with Soul Sessions, who I think you have
them now as well, yes.
And then obviously like the Dubai one was really cool. And I've done a couple of other ones. But I enjoy doing it. I think because I do, like we've mentioned throughout this whole thing, because I'm a little bit older, I've got some life experience. I think like I'm able to kind of express my thoughts and feelings in a way that potentially other people might not. And I think that's what makes me a little bit different. I'm very open and honest about my journey and how I feel about things, because I feel like there's bound to be somebody else who feels the same way as me, you know? So I try to be as down to earth as possible, because, you know, we're all in this together, and it takes everyone to build what it is that we do. So, if I can inspire someone in some sort of way, then that's the end goal.
Perfect. Right. So just before we go, of course, there is merch. You have merch now.
I do.
You've got 80s styled retro merch. Is that something you designed yourself? So you're quite creative in yourself. Is that something you made and put out there? Did you feel you were ready to put out some merch?
Yeah, people had been asking, and I'd kind of held off. And I just thought I'd see how it went, because people kept asking. So, you know, for the amount of people that asked, that's how many that's how many t-shirts I got made, and they're pretty much half gone already. So it was a bit of an impulse decision. I'd been thinking about it for a long time, and then I just felt like I would just go for it. I've got a couple of t-shirts, but it was my brother-in-law that designed it. So he designed the Sherry Martel gear. And then he designed those two. So very grateful.
If people wanted to buy one, and this is my not so subtle way to get your social media handles in, if people wanted to buy a Daisy Jenkins inspired merch t-shirt, where can they go?
So to buy it, I've got a Big Cartel store, so daisyjenkins.bigcartel.com. You can also find all the links for that on my Instagram, which is daisy.jenkinspw, and Daisy Jenkins on Facebook, and daisy.jenkinspw on Twitter. But I may have got that wrong. I don't use Twitter all that often.
Sorry, I heard the wee disdain in your voice there for just mentioning Twitter or X or whatever it is, because you finally made it there, and I think it all died pretty much afterwards with it going to X and everything. So, you arrived just in time for it to hopefully go away. But anyway, right, I'll leave you to the rest of the day, because I know when it's like if you get a cough stuck there, that the last thing you want to do is talk any longer, because you'll end up coughing through every question. I can sympathize with that entirely. So I'll leave you to the rest of your day. But thank you very much for taking the time to catch up, and maybe next year we'll get year three.
Well, what could happen in the next year? Who knows?
Exactly. Top rope move. Top rope move. Move. That's it.
Oh, that's good. Right. Spoiler alert. It might be done within the next month.
Fingers crossed. But thank you very much.
Thank you so much.